I'm gonna give you another chance, Mason. Where are them horses?
Told you already, I sold them. Why do you think I'd start lying to you this late in life? Don't you ever close doors? No wonder I can't pay the gas bill.
Who'd you sell them to?
I ain't gonna tell you. If people bought a horse, they didn't pay to have some kid come bothering them.
Mace, Rowdy's mine. You just can't sell something that isn't yours.
You can't live on no money either. They got a good home. I made sure of that. Are they gone? So shut up about it.
Mason, you just better get those horses back.
I ain't getting them back. We couldn't have kept feeding them much longer anyway. Either they would have starved to death or we would. So just shut up about it.
You get those horses back.
I ain't getting them back. Texas, you better quit it. You know, you're strong, Tex, but you never could fight worth a damn.
Come on. Get my horse.
Ain't gonna find him, I told you.
If Pop was here, I wouldn't let you sell
him. If Pop was here, I wouldn't either sell him. That's the point.
A scene from Tex starring Matt Dillon, written by my guest right now, S.E. Hinton. Susie, Hi. Thanks for being here.
Thank you.
Let me ask you, first of all, since this film is based on your book, how pleased are you with the movie
version?
I'm
real pleased. I am amazed at how close it is to the book. The screenplay was used just chunks of my dialogue, and it was as close to the book as it could get.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought the cast was excellent. They all did. True to characterization is really more important to me than being true to the plot. It's the character's the important thing to me, and you know, I'm just real happy at the movie.
I know you have said, at least I think I'm quoting you correctly, when you said when you begin a book or when you're writing a book, you tend to think more about character than overall.
Well, I know where my characters are different in the end of a book than they are in the beginning. Mm-hmm. Is that I want to show some kind of stage of character growth. So my characters are real clear in my head before I ever begin. But I can't plot my way to the Safeway store, so I have a real, you know, tough time getting from the beginning to the end, and that's the hard part for me.
I'm glad to hear you were pleased with the film, because we hear so many horror stories about writers.
Oh, I know. I didn't want Disney to do it when they first approached me. My agent called and said, well, Disney's interested in doing Tex. I said, Disney? They'd make a Tex meet Seven Dwarfs. I don't want anything to do with that. And the next thing I know, Tom Wilhite from Disney is on my doorstep, came to Tulsa and convinced me that, you know, they wanted to widen their audience, and they wanted to change their image a little bit, and they wanted to do a realistic teenage film, and he convinced me. He also mm-hmm. promised my horse the lead horse, so
that
got
did
the
it.
Book. I did it, yeah.
Your books have sold literally millions and millions of copies. What, this may be one of those unanswerable questions, but what is it that you think is the primary appeal to young readers in your books?
They recognize themselves in my books. I deal realistically with teenagers. I talk about what they're... I don't sugar things up for them. Matter of fact, two of my books have very, what you call, tragic endings. I try not to lie to them.
Mm-hmm.
I think they appreciate that. Also, I happen to be very fond of teenagers as a group, and I think maybe that comes across.
Most of your characters, or your lead characters, are written from them. The male point of view. Now, has that been difficult?
No. I like boys. When I was growing up, most of my close friends are boys. I was doing boy stuff because this was pre-liberation, and what women got to do when I was in high school was write their hair and outline their eyes in black, and it was not interesting for all day long. So I was out doing boy stuff with footballs and fights and stuff, and I thought, you know, I'll write this and say a girl's doing it. Nobody's going to believe it. Another thing, I didn't know if it was convincing or not, because I didn't identify with anything the girls we're doing,
mm-hmm.
but I know I'm convincing from a boy's point of view, as I get letters from guys all the time who think I'm a guy.
Yeah. Do you have a set procedure as far as writing is concerned? Do you, like, get up at 8 in the morning, write for four hours, and stop?
I'm very undisciplined. I haven't used the same method in it twice in a row. Besides that, I keep changing my typewriter. I keep thinking I'm going to find the magic one, you know, that's going to write it for me. Because I'm lazy also, so I've got all these things against me. On the other hand, I do love to write, so that's the big push.
So if the, for want of a better word, the inspiration is there, you could sit down and write for 10 straight hours or whatever.
Yeah. But sometimes you can make yourself write. You can honestly lock yourself in a room and make yourself write. But there are times you could lock yourself in the room and you can't.
Mm-hmm.
And you can tell it within 10 minutes, so you don't have to stay in the room all day, actually, to find that out.
What kind of advice do you give to a young person who would ask you, how do I become a writer?
Read. Read everything. I started writing in grade school, and I just read everything. So the time I wrote The Outsiders, I wrote it in high school. I was 16. People think, oh, this 16-year-old kid just said I wrote a book. But I've been writing for 8 years. I've been training myself.
Mm-hmm.
And if you read, you can subconsciously, things like sentence structure and paragraphing are going to be in your mind, and all you'll have to do is worry about what your characters are going to do. All the technical stuff will be in your subconscious. So I'm an intuitive writer. I mean, that I can't, while I'm writing, give you an intellectual reason for what I'm doing. Years later, I can look back and maybe see a process where I can kind of rationalize it, but it just goes on feeling with me while I'm doing it. As a matter of fact, I made a D in creative writing when I was the year I was writing The Outsiders, my junior year in high school. I made a D in creative writing.
What about changing stylistically? Do you think it's possible? For example, do you see, or could you see yourself 10 or 15 years from now writing in a different style than you're writing in now?
I see my style changing. In every book, my style is a little bit different. I know it's recognizable as me, but like the book, I'm working on a fifth book now, and I'm using a third-person narration for the first time. And it's been kind of interesting so far. But I think you can pick up, what I try to do is change my narrator. When you're reading Tex's story, if you put that down in the middle and went over and picked up, let's say, Rumblefish, you could tell immediately this is a totally different person telling the story, there wouldn't be any confusion there.
Mm-hmm. Right now, in the earlier part of the program, Matt gave us a good description of how he saw the character of Tex. What is it about this guy that you think will, because obviously there aren't just millions and millions of guys like this particular one. So what kind of insight can a kid in New York City gain by watching Tex?
I think any kid will recognize somebody who's not particularly interested in school, who gets in trouble here and there, but he's not a bad person. His difficulties are his relationships with his family and his peer groups. I think that's a universal. It'll appeal to everybody. One thing I'm kind of proud of with this book is the story of the kid who's fighting to get out has been told so many times.
Mm-hmm.
And Mason is one of those kids, Tex's brother. But Tex is not particularly going anywhere, and there's lots of people who aren't particularly going anywhere. That doesn't mean that they're not valuable, productive human beings. They're people who stay. And I wanted to tell that story for a change.
Have you ever gotten involved in a book with what you thought was a central character, only to find yourself more drawn to one of the other characters you were creating?
Well, actually, in my third book, Rumblefish, the narrator is not the story. The story is the story of the motorcycle boy, and the narrator is his younger brother. But I wanted to, that's a real funny, kind of a strange book I can't get into anyway, but I do that. A lot of times, your narrator is not your central character. Maybe it's just somebody's eyes to see it through. Now, Tex was the central character. I wanted people to feel like they had lived that kid's life with him for a while when they got through with the book. And I think that's exactly the same feeling that you walk out of the movie with.
Yeah. Let me get your opinion on this. And I've known this about other writers, but the one that sticks in my mind is Margaret Mitchell in Gone with the Wind, for obvious reasons, being in Atlanta. It's well known that she apparently wrote the last chapter of Gone with the Wind first. And I'm told that other writers often will write a middle chapter or a chapter near the end. And to me, that's rather like, it's almost impossible to understand how that can be done. Could you explain?
Oh, yes, sure. Because when I start a book, I know how I want it to end. I mean, I know where I want the character to be. I could write the last paragraph, the first thing. I don't usually. I usually save it for the last because it's the funnest, it's the easiest, it's kind of like your wrap party on your book is to do your last chapter.
But when you begin a book, you know all about that character.
Yeah, and I know where he wants to be. I know where I want him, how I want him to have changed or developed. But how I get the incidents to get him to that spot, are my hard thing. I know what he's like in the beginning, I know what he's like at the end, but what's going to happen to him to finally get him there?
Yeah.
That's the hard part for me. Now, you know, other writers, plot's the easiest part. Dialogue's real easy for me.
It's still a mind-boggling thing for me. You were involved in a number of your books right now reaching the screen, and this is rather an unusual thing, I would think, to have so many of your books at one time.
It's really strange. They all popped at once. But see, I've turned down offers for The Outsiders throughout the years. Not that I think it's the Holy Writ or anything, but a lot of kids really love that book, and I didn't want to see it messed up for them. But when Zoetrope called me, I had just seen The Black Stallion, and I had literally walked out of the theater going, boy, if that had been my book and my movie, I'd been really pleased. And like a week later, they called and said, we're interested in doing The Outsiders. And when I found out who they were, I said, great. And the same week, Disney called me. And they didn't know anything about each other. But then when Francis and I worked together real well, I was a consultant on The Outsiders. And he said, what else have you written, Susie? And I said, well, I've got this really weird book called Rumblefish nobody understands. Man, Dylan understands it, I said, but hardly anybody else understands it. And Francis said, I'll get it. And he read it, and he sat me down. He said, well, Susie, this is so different, and you've done this and this, and did all these things that nobody's ever picked up on, and told them to me. And I said, yeah, you're right. He said, let's co-author a screenplay and get it on. Let's get going. He said, I'm set up here. We've got Matt here. He's perfect for Rusty James, and let's get going. So we just finished The Outsiders like 3 weeks ago, and we're going to start rehearsals Saturday on Rumblefish.
Marvelous. Well, we are out of time, and you certainly have a hit on your hands with Tex.
Thanks.
And I want to thank you, and I want to thank Matt Dillon for being here, and I hope to see you again.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you. My thanks to all of you for watching. Until next time, good night.